good afternoon. My name's Julia Powles. I'm here at Cambridge, affiliate of the Democracy and Tech Project, and work across the law faculty and the computer lab. And my takeaway from the first three sessions is that the session everybody really wanted to be in was this algorithmic power one. And perhaps because it's at the nexus of where those traditional concerns, as David outlined at the beginning, are really seeing something new and different that wouldn't be on a conference program a century ago. And I'm really excited about this panel. I think it brings together people with really diverse experiences from different regions and from different disciplinary backgrounds. So we're going to have a talk first from Seda Guerses, who's speaking from an engineering perspective, but has done really fantastic mixed methods research. Then we're going to have Malte Ziewitz, who has come out as a closet lawyer, but now hangs out with people in STS studies and ethnography. And then Ariel Ezrachi, who's the director of the Competition Law and Policy Centre at Oxford, and really at the forefront of, I think, a really exciting progressive turn in competition law. And the interesting thing is I think all of our panelists have speak often in different events about the sorts of topics that we're discussing here. Ariel comes straight from Chicago, where I think it's really exciting to hear that in the house of laissez-faire, they're starting to worry about platform power. And I think that the different perspectives on power and powerlessness are something that are going to be really interesting to hear from this panel. So I'm going to turn it to Seda to take away.
This one. Oh, wait, just one second. I'm going to have to do something else. This is going to be the way it is. This is going to be... Nope. Okay, so I'm going to show you the slide because it's kind of fun. this is what you get when you ask for a power switch Cambridge bunch. All right, so I'm going to speak about a project that I'm sharing with or doing together with Joris van Hoboken for about a year and a half and with Marta Poon in the last year. And I'm going to call it Pooling and Pushing the Clouds. And once I do this, I'm going to come out of the slide view because then I can't see my notes. All right. So one of the questions that the three of us have been asking ourselves is, why are we so concerned about algorithms or data today? A lot of our colleagues work under these umbrella terms, either algorithm or data. How do we get to, for example, have a panel today on the same level as corporations, media, and state? That's called algorithms. Like, how do these things even compare? And how do we get here? And who benefits from us in rooms like this talking about algorithms and data? What are the political economies that discussions about data and algorithms prop up, keep up? So these are big questions, especially for a 10-minute talk. But I'd like to give an account based on one story of how software is produced. And the reason I'm very interested in this is I think we've had a turn where we've been looking at how technology is consumed, and we have stopped looking at how technology is produced. And the claim I'm going to make with respect to software engineering is that consumption and production has been collapsed. So we need to do those two things together. I'll convince you, hopefully, of that in the next few minutes. And the cloud, if you haven't heard of it, it could be Amazon Cloud, or now Google has a cloud too, and Microsoft has Azure, is where software production is increasingly moving to. So I'm going to talk about two kind of activities related to software production. One I'm going to say is the pull on the cloud, and the other one is the push of the cloud onto us. So the cloud is not just somebody else's computer, as that says a sticker that's on my computer here, but I'm going to claim that it's an economic and colonial device. It's the result, in my story, of a long discussion about labor and software production that started with the software crisis meeting, which was organized by NATO in 1968. So what was happening back then is a lot of software projects were failing. Over 75% of the software projects were failing. There were serious considerations about whether software engineering is a managerial task, where you define a problem and then put it into its pieces, or if it's something that requires expertise, something that developers know how to do. But before going to the software engineering story, I want to talk about the pendulum theory of technology. So the pendulum theory says in the 50s all the way through the 70s, we had time sharing and mainframes. With the 1980s, we got personal computing, so we all of a sudden could do our computation on our devices. And then now we're back to the cloud, which resembles a lot the time-sharing and mainframe machines from the 50s to the 70s. This story makes it look like it is about hardware and processing power, but I really want to go back to software. And in order to make my point about software, I need to go back to my slides. All right, so next slide is here. And let me just start it. So who knows what is going on here? Okay, who knows? Who knows? Put your hand up. Microsoft, what's happening? Windows what? 8, no, come. 95, yes, okay. This is, say it again. It's a Rolling Stones song. Okay, so this is Microsoft celebrating the release of Windows 95. It was such a big deal, they lit up the Empire State Building in New York, right? Like, it doesn't happen very often that companies do that now. This is the kind of high point of what we call shrink wrap software. Who knows what shrink wrap software is? Okay, that tells you you're older than most people in this room. Okay. shrink wrap software is basically your ability to go to a shop and you have a bunch of shells with software on it. You buy it, you go home, and you install it on your computer, and you basically can use it then, right? And the transaction that you have with the company begins and ends as you go to the shop and buy the software. What has happened over the last 15 years is what I would say a shift from shrink wrap software to services. And this is really important. The reason that Microsoft can afford a party with the Windows 95 release is because they release every 2-3 years. But what happened in the last 17 years is that no longer is the software running on your computer, but it's running on the servers of the companies, right? This is why it's a service. You connect to the server, and it serves you this functionality that you want to have. Very basic example, Microsoft Word. I'm assuming many of you have used it. Maybe you use other open source alternatives. But what has shifted in with the move to the services is, for example, Google Docs or Office 365. The software is no longer installed on your computer. The binary does not need to be fitted to your hardware. You just open a browser, and you can now do your word processing on that server. Okay, why is that important? What is the difference? Well, it's very hard to maintain and very costly to give users software, right? You give it to them, they're in control. You know, it's the situation of like your mom or dad calling you, help me with my Microsoft Word, it's not working. So all of that is taken care of. Also for larger corporations, enterprises who would buy your software, the maintenance becomes much easier if the code remains under your hands and they always come to you to use it. In addition, you get all the data about how your software is being used, right? I will talk about what that means, what that enables in a moment. And what's also important is you do not have a one-time sale of the license of the software, but you go into a rent model, right? So you can constantly get money, or as some people say, pay with your data, have users pay with their data. So what is also interesting, again, with respect to software engineering, is it allows a certain movement that started in the 80s and then came to power in the 90s and mostly in the 2000s, called agile programming. Here I have the Extreme Programming Manifesto, which says that we should not do big design up front, right? When Microsoft took 2 or 3 years to develop software, they would first come up with the requirements, and then they would go into design, and then eventually they would produce something that could be tested and evaluated and put in the world. And once it was in the world, there was not much they could change. But once you have the code right next to you, next to your developers, you can rapidly change that code, right? And not only can you rapidly change that code, you can constantly test it on the users, because the users are connecting to your servers, you see their every move. So you can look at how each and every feature is being used. You can do A/B testing now, right? So, and you can rapidly release software. These guys would not have time to dance, or they would have to dance maybe 50 times a day if they would celebrate every software release. Okay. So if we look at what has changed with the move from shrink wrap software, you know, the boxes that of software that you install on your computer, to services, is summarized in my amazing depiction here, which is that the transaction now with the company that you're using the software of is throughout your use. So the bottom depicts what's happening with services. The top is what happened with shrink wrap. And what also happens is, whereas in shrink wrap software you had very clear delineated time of production, and then afterwards, once you sold the software, people used it, but those were two separate phases. Now you have the two collapsed, right? So what you have now is you actually use the traffic of the users to decide how you're going to continue to produce your software. And you can constantly change your software, so that's a feature space that is constantly changing over time. What also happened through the services is that you no longer have to do everything yourself. You can basically pull other services and wrap them into your own website. So when you go to a website, it looks like you're going to a one service provider, but it could be that the payment is from PayPal, the login is from Facebook, the photo albums are from Flickr. So you're basically talking to about 30 services who might be also pulling in other services to give you whatever functionality is on that one website. So this has two effects. One is that for the user, this is mostly invisible, but if, for example, Facebook integrates itself over 2,000 websites, then it gets the data from these 2,000 websites, okay? So that means they can pool data. Okay, let me get back to my notes here. So, one of the important things that changes then with software engineering is that they can now do data-centric development. And here I want to make a provocative statement. I think for a long time, many of my colleagues, scholars, activists, and journalists have focused on the advertisement industry as the problem, right? They're profiling us. But when I talk with software engineers today, I understand how intensely the data that they're getting by looking at how we use software is central to how they're doing software engineering, increasingly so. So I actually think, after having all these interviews, that the Silicon Valley and tech companies threw the advertisement industry under the bus while they had us keeping talking about advertisement while they kept on doing software engineering based on data. So not only do these software companies need our data to see if the features are working, basically if they're being used by many people for a long time, but they also have been bringing in all these services from other parties, so they need to track that all the services are doing what they promised. So you track the users, then you track all the services, and now you have a meta-tracking problem. Are you sure you're tracking everything? Right, so you need to track your tracking, et cetera, et cetera. So this is a very tracking-intensive industry now, software engineering. So you can imagine, once you have your code on your server, and you have piles of data coming from the users, you need big data centers. So the point I want to make is, in my story, this is not the only story, software engineering has pulled on what we know as the cloud. But I think that the cloud is also being pushed on us. And here I'm going to rely on Martha Poon's work, who does work on financial markets, and she studies the cloud as an investment object. Billions are currently being invested into building the cloud. Her hunch is, this is work that's ongoing, that the capital flows that have been looking for a new object since the housing crisis and the meltdown of the 2008 financial market meltdown, they found a new home in the cloud. She is specifically investigating the way in which Microsoft is pivoting into becoming a cloud company by borrowing from the financial markets. They have a lot of cash, but they borrow to do this pivot. If so, in order to pay back the debt, the cloud needs to succeed, in which case it is also being pushed. And this push has structure that we have to study. We haven't studied it yet, but our hunch is to succeed, the cloud is pushing on the body, so all the fitness and health stuff, on the home, the city, on production and manufacturing, education, and et cetera. And the cloud, because of the debt and the money that needs to be paid back, needs to be cheaper, faster, and bigger, which means it definitely will be pushing on costs of materials and labor, which will have local and global impact on all of these domains. And most importantly, a lot of my colleagues have studied the impact, the social impact of technologies on individuals, but it also has a huge impact on institutions, and I think this was coming out very nicely in all the panels today. Institutions have to adapt in this scenario to accelerated production. The cloud envisions an economy of agile companies. Companies need to be lightweight, fast, mobile, if not strategically parasitic. It is hence no surprise that we increasingly hear of things like business agility, so agile development all of a sudden becomes a business concept, of institutional agility, organizational agility, which basically are signs of these pressures that are coming onto institutions if the cloud is to succeed. Little pause. So this is the point where a lot of people that listen to me get rather depressed because I present the cloud as almost a vision of a global supercomputational infrastructure, and I see how that could happen. And so one could fall into a sense of powerlessness. So that's my connection to the theme of the day. So let me take one deep breath and propose some ways to deal with these developments. And these are just ideas, and I hope that it will excite you and we can talk afterwards. So the cloud is a promise which has some tangible reality, but it is not inevitable. So we need to show where the promises of the cloud companies, both to financial markets, to technology consumers, but also to institutions and their employees, work and fail. A project of this kind needs to engage with the development of the cloud effectively. It needs to address its political economy and underline why and how the cloud is not inevitable. One way to do that is to better understand the processes that produce datafication and algorithms. Without understanding why we have data and algorithms, the forces behind them, we can at times follow the wrong leads too long. And I think this is what happened with the advertisement and all the work that we have done around that. Second, how is the introduction of the cloud with its ideology of agility and cheap processing transforming our institutions and not just individuals? I think we need to switch to maybe other frames, not just institutions, but this is what I came up for today. Algorithms and data as discursive constructs have a tendency to abstract away from actual companies, governments, people, situations, institutions, and economic moves. We cannot afford to abstract these away. Today, we are at this conundrum. If the cloud works, we're potentially stepping into an infrastructure with transnational ambitions of control and efficiency. If it fails, we're potentially looking at a sort of financial collapse comparable to the 2008 housing crisis. Surely there are other possible futures for the cloud. In any case, it would be good to ask who will be affected by such a success, positively or negatively, or by such a failure? Who will pay for this if it fails? So this has a consequence that we cannot limit research and policy questions to the impact that the cloud and technologies has on fundamental rights like privacy or algorithmic discrimination. It is important to expand those questions to include an analysis of cloud infrastructures and their transformation of our fundamental institutions. And finally, I'm a computer scientist, so I have to think about what do I do? Is the cloud and associated production models really the better way to go? Have we studied this? Do we have any empirical data on this? I don't think so. Many of my colleagues will say it's a lot of snake oil, and they will not believe that some of the things that are happening on the cloud are as efficient as they claim. The usual motto is, you know, it's all held together by duct tape. But I do think that we have to go a little deeper. How does the cloud and the associated practices of software engineering transform our scientific practices and conceptions of software? How does it impact our designs for privacy, security, fairness, and transparency? These seem like computational questions, but I have to admit they're also legal and social ones, and I think there's a great urgency to engage in them here and now. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone, for organizing this. John, Julia, Judith, whatever your names are. It's a treat to be here. And I'm serious about it. It's really good to be here. It's a great pleasure. All right, so I would like to share a confusion with you that has been haunting me for a couple of years now. And this confusion has to do with the recent rise of algorithms who somehow left their safe haven of mathematics and computer science and have been on this journey through all kinds of social sciences, public policy, law, and so on. And probably many of you, as Seda actually already mentioned, we have a panel today on algorithmic power. Algorithms seem to have become a bit of a modern myth, so they pop up in all these headlines, in newspaper articles, where maybe 4 or 5 years ago we had the words like technology or computer or device. Now we have algorithm there. So it's become this kind of mysterious, really interesting concept, and that's something that I'm very much interested in as a social scientist, as a sociologist, and as an ethnographer. So here's my confusion I want to share with you. So the confusion is the following. On the one hand, we have all these claims that algorithms are said to govern, shape, sort, select, determine, or otherwise regulate or control our lives. But then on the other hand, algorithms are strangely obscure, right? There's inscrutable, we don't really know what they are and what these things are. It's easy to use this word. We have a lot of sentences that we start with the word of algorithm, which put it in the subject position of algorithms do this, algorithms do that, and so on. But it's really difficult to wrap one's brains around what is actually going on. So this is my confusion. On the one hand, a very powerful entity, appropriate for this conference. On the other hand, but also somewhat inscrutable, which is reminiscent of a lot of concepts that we've had in the social sciences over a long time. So for markets, we had the invisible hands, for evolution, we had natural selection, and so on. So there's a lot of these kind of secret, hidden, powerful, but yet inscrutable entities. So a lot of people have now started thinking about this concept of the algorithm from a social science perspective, and there's a whole range of things that people have suggested. So some suggest to revert to the original definitions in computer science and mathematics. Some have suggested that we just work with a common sense definition because it's an elevator word, as Stephen as Hacking would call it anyway. And some have suggested more refined theorizations of algorithms as material history, as algorithmic assemblage, as power through the algorithm by Scott Lesch. So there's a whole kind of space opening up, and all of us basically are sociologists, political scientists, ethnographers, lawyers, and so on. We're having a bit of a field day now, filling this space in this mysterious confusion of this entity of the algorithm. So what I would like to do today is share a small part of my own journey of making sense of this puzzle and of my own attempts to know an algorithm as an ethnographer and social scientist, and I hope I'll be able to share some useful insights about this idea of algorithmic power along the way. So this is a classic venue for studying algorithmic power, I would suggest. It happens to be my field site, quite literally. This is a search engine results page, which probably all of you recognize. As some of my interlocutors in the search marketing industry would say, this is the war zone of the 10 blue links, because it's actually a highly contested area. This is a search for yoga mats, and I think everyone understands in this room what it means to be on this first page if you have a lot of yoga mats to sell. So when I started this project in 2009, my idea of studying this setting was actually rather straightforward, and with hindsight, really naive. So my idea was to do what ethnographers usually do and actually join the tribe and try to understand how something like this comes about in practice. So unfortunately, as you might imagine, this turned out to be rather difficult. So already finding an email address of someone from Google on Google was virtually impossible. So people don't have email addresses, it seems, or at least not in public. And so even when I managed to get in touch with someone in the search quality team or in the web spend team, I ended up with materials like this. So this is an example of a response I got to one of my inquiries. It's a response to a request for a meeting that was itself considered so sensitive and confidential that I'm not even allowed to share it here, and possibly I'm not even allowed to claim that it ever existed under some NDA that was out there. There's a lot of lawyers in the room, you know how these things work, and write them yourselves. But this is the sort of challenge that you face when you try to study search engine results pages and these forms of rankings in practice. So that was a bit of a failure, a miserable failure, and of course this went on even when I met an in-house ethnographer at Google, for instance. I thought there might be some solidarity, right, from one ethnographer to another ethnographer, but that did not work out quite too. And actually, in many ways, this is not surprising, right, the secrecy. I mean, to anyone working in any corporation, in tech corporation, this is a common trope, this idea of secrecy. In fact, in 2012, Udi Manba, at the time he was the senior vice president of engineering at Google, wrote in public, actually, for something that is used so often by so many people, surprisingly little is known about ranking at Google. This is entirely our fault, and it is by design. We are, to be honest, quite secretive about what we do. The details of the ranking algorithms are in many ways Google's crown jewels. So this is an enactment of this classic idea of corporate confidentiality and security. You don't want anyone else to know basically your secret sauce for a variety of reasons, which then for someone who wants to study these things in practice, of course, poses a bit of a challenge. So that was not really surprising, but what was surprising that is the more time I spend among people trying to figure out Google search, mainly in the search marketing industry, among a profession called search engine optimization consultants, or SEO consultants, and the more I realized that a lot of people claim that there actually is not much of a secret, right? So for instance, when I intercepted a Google representative after a panel like this one and was trying to get into a conversation to talk about a possible research project, then usually the answer was that you don't have to worry about anything. There's no need for an interview. It's all online, actually. We're very public about what we do. And in fact, once you start looking around, you find reports like this. In the past, we've published information about search on the official Google blog, more than 400 posts about search, and more than 50 weekly wrap-ups and webmaster-oriented posts on the Google Webmaster Central blog with more than 300 posts. We also operate a help center for search and another for webmasters. That's not to mention the search help forums, which have more than 50,000 discussions, and the Webmaster Central Help forums with more than 90,000. Combine this with YouTube channels and search conferences, and it is safe to say that we talk. Oops, that was one too far. See, that we talk a lot about search. So this was quite confusing when I started out with this project. So on the one hand, there was this thing that's supposedly so secret. On the other hand, it is also very public, right? And people talk about this a lot. So how can you talk about something so much and say so little, right? What is this back and forth of secrecy that is going on there? Or in the words of the anthropologist of Marilyn Strathern, we can ask her wonderful question of, what does transparency conceal? So these are the kind of questions you get into, right? These are the kind of questions you get into when you try to figure this out yourself and take notes and then try to connect it to some theoretical themes. My confusion got worse then, and this is the last point about the confusion actually, when I actually started interviewing search engine optimization consultants, so people who actually faced a very similar problem as I did. So this is a quote from one of my first interviews with a seasoned and long-time SEO called Derek. This happened in the British Library of all places. And so at some point then I asked him about this algorithm thing, right? I said, well, isn't it super important for you guys to figure it out? Because you have all these discussion forums where you try to figure out the latest update. These updates have names and so on, and you run experiments and tests on how to figure these things out to get this little competitive edge over your other search marketers. And this is what he said. He said, if you try and solve the riddle, if you try to come up with your own mathematical version of Google, you're dead. You're dead in the water. You can't do it, you know. Nobody at Google could do it. Larry and Sergey would not be able to sit there and say, here's my algorithm, you know. There's too much stuff in there. So now my confusion was completely, utterly complete, actually, because there was this secret thing. People talked a lot about this, but now I was told that it's actually unknowable. So it's not available to epistemic practices on a day-to-day basis. So this is pretty fascinating, and it's all very fascinating against the backdrop of our talk about algorithms, and including my own, right, and their power and what they do. So what is going on there? So what I did then is I drew on some resources that are quite prominent in my field, in the field of science and technology studies. There is a couple of versions of that, but usually what is a good advice when you run into a problem like that, you try to turn the resource you want to use for your analysis into a topic. This is the idea of the topic resource distinction, and you can just invert it and turn your resource into a topic. And this is what happens a lot in science studies, right? People did not study science in itself, but how science was being done, how it was achieved. So this is the inversion that I did here myself. And so this then leads you to think about algorithms, not as this powerful yet inscrutable entity, but as a topic of empirical study and as a theme that is mobilized, not just by us researchers and analysts and journalists, but also by people who work with them on a day-to-day basis. And this is then the work of understanding the search marketing industry, of engaging with these people on a day-to-day basis. So the question then becomes, It's not so, okay, do we have to know these algorithms, or do we have to, what about transparency and so on? But the question becomes, well, how do algorithms figure in the everyday work of SEO consultants and their interactions with search representatives, users, databases, computers, and so on? So just a short overview. I don't have any time to go into any of this in detail. There's lots of great stories in there which would highlight different aspects of many of the themes that we've been talking about today. This is just to give you a short taste of the things that I did. So I spent a couple of months with a small search engine optimization agency outside another university town in England. I spend a lot of time at search conferences. These conferences are fascinating venues for trying to understand these interactions and the dynamics about, talk about algorithms, but also many other things. I dived into a lot of the online discussions and forums. I actually took part in a search engine optimization in 6-hour trainings. And there's, of course, a growing library of advice literature, like Search Engine for Dummies, which in itself is a super interesting phenomenon. So I think these things are all connected to what we're talking about, but we rarely talk about these mundane, everyday things. So already analyzing some of this advice literature and how it goes about presenting the problem and the challenge for someone who wants to have their website ranked higher in search engine results pages would be really interesting. And finally, of course, I talked to a lot of people in the industry and also webmasters. Not surprisingly, the search engine optimization industry has quite a few celebrity speakers on the conference circuit. So the gentleman up there on the left with a beard, this is Ralf Tegmeier. He's better known by the name of Phantom Master. He's one of the more famous black hat search engine optimizers who does all these kinds of gaming practices that are themselves quite secret. So there you see, you get further into these loops, and then these are some other people I talked with. So these are some of the things I did, and what you get from this is an engagement with people who not necessarily talk about these problems in the way that we talk about in this room, but to talk about these problems as part of their everyday work, as, if you like, lay people, in a sense, if you want to use this old sociological distinction between lay sociologists and professional sociologists, we would probably qualify as one as professional sociologists, and these people think about these things, but not in the sense of writing articles or papers and so on. So it's, one of my goals here is to try to figure out how these things work in practice. So last slide, I would like to suggest that we think about not just algorithmic power, but maybe also about power after algorithms or beyond algorithms. And I want to encourage us to be courageous, that in our inquiries into all these systems and settings, into all these concerns, that there might be a good chance that we lose some of the phenomena that we started out with. Anyone who's done any empirical research has recognized this. At some point, it's really tough to cling to what you wanted to study in the first place. And so losing this phenomenon is actually perfectly fine and can get you into interesting other areas. So what I would like to suggest then, that among SEO consultants and those from my ongoing study, the algorithm, as we talk about it, is both a topic and a resource of inquiry. I want to suggest that by opening up the study and the topic of algorithms and algorithmic power in that way to people who deal with that on a day-to-day basis, it gives us an opportunity to rethink some classical tropes and problems about transparency, about accountability, participation, as practices of power in their own right. What do I mean by that? Here are some sample questions, and these are some examples of how your questions change once you start dealing with people who push you in certain directions just by virtue of talking to you. So for instance, this is the question I already mentioned. You can start asking not about secrecy and secrecy as a problem for policymakers and so on, but you can ask, you can talk about secrecy, about revelation and concealment as a practice of power in its own right. And there is a lot of that going on, which is really interesting. You can ask about how algorithms become these entities that then enter relations of accountability. So I think Mireille mentioned this morning this moment of computer says no, right? This is a clear moment in which you defer accountability to a computer, and you find this in many situations where accountability is deferred to this other entity. And for that, it's of course completely convenient and very nice to have this entity, the so-called algorithm, to then push any responsibility to? That's a very interesting question too. So when does this happen? By whom and for what, to what ends? How do people distinguish between different forms of participation, especially ethical participation as foreseen by the operators of these platforms, and then so-called unethical manipulation? That's one of the main challenges of an industry like search engine optimization. And trying to figure out this kind of really tricky boundary is a huge task and requires a lot of mundane everyday work that's important to study. And then finally, a fourth example of a question is, of course, one that I'm most interested in. Well, what is it actually to resist a search engine results page, right? I mean, is what these search engine optimization consultants doing, is that a form of resistance? Well, not really. They're kind of contributing to what's going on, right? There's this ongoing back and forth between trying to optimize and then the engineers tweaking the algorithm a bit more. This is, it's a bit like a tug of war. So what does it mean then to talk about resistance, and how does that come out in these situations? So in short, I think maybe this is trivial to say, but I think it's still important to mention power in this case, or algorithmic power, appears as an upshot of our practices and theories of power, and that does not just include the theories that that you mentioned this morning about another taxonomy of six dimensions and so on, but that also, of course, applies to the everyday theories that people have about their theories of power, like someone like Derek, the search engine optimization consultant, someone who runs a website for a hair salon somewhere up in Birmingham, and all these other people who deal with these things, and I think who we haven't really talked much about today, and in policy discourses, I think we often lose in these debates. So thank you very much.
Okay, hi everyone. So, the perspective I would like to present to you and to discuss with you is one of competition law, and how the story that we heard today, how does this affect the markets that we have online, how does it affect trade online, commerce, services, and much wider, the environment in which we operate. And this is quite a fascinating area. In fact, it's probably at the moment at the forefront of the public debate in antitrust and competition. And this is because the base presumption that we have is that the internet is actually a blessing when it comes to competition, because of course the internet brings with it the promise of everything. It's the perfect market for those of you who are familiar with the basic model. You have endless choice, endless options. You have the power to reduce your search costs, and therefore the competitive power is likely to be immense. And what I would like to explore in the time I have is actually why this is not necessarily the case. But I should say, of course, I will focus about the issues that are more problematic. The base assumption is still that the internet is beneficial to us. So when we speak about the counterfactual, it's not that I am proposing let's ditch the internet and let's go back to a pre-internet period. What we're actually discussing is whether at the moment we are getting the best deal, or whether what happens is that we really have now an attempt by providers to change the distribution of welfare in our game. So you can view it as an initial wave where the internet gave us all these efficiencies, all these benefits, and following that, following us basically gaining more welfare, now providers are being able through technology to basically try and change the equation, get a bit more of that welfare and make use of it. And my comments are based largely on a book I published with Maurice Stuckey from Tennessee, Virtual Competition. And the bottom line of it is that competition, as we know it, competition where you have the invisible hand, where you assume that there is this amazing dynamic that will ensure that you will get the best price, the best quality. And we know that even in the real world, it doesn't really work that well. But what I can assure you is that that invisible hand in our universe that we discuss has long been displaced by what we refer to as the digitalized hand. In other words, what you see when you go online has very little to do with the ideas that we have of market power, market dynamics, because everything, in a way, is artificial. So what we have is we have a new environment that looks very much the same like the market that you would go to. So it's like the market for apples or fish that you will go. It has the choice, it has everything. And yet, because this market is monitored, what you have is the possibility for that market to be manipulated. And in fact, this is exactly what we have. So I'm going to focus only on two examples. The first one will be behavioral discrimination. And here the proposition is that each of you, when you go online, what you see in front of you is not a reflection of a market. What you see is what we refer to as the Truman Show. You see a reality that was designed specifically for you. You see options that are being marketed to you as this is for you. This is because you gave us information, we're providing you with a service, exactly what would suit your needs best. And yet, in reality, this Truman Show in a two-side market where the providers are actually gaining the money, not from you because the service is free, but from the other side of the market, what you have is a market that is often manipulated. How is it manipulated? I will not speak about ads, but I will speak about dynamic pricing and personalized pricing. So this is now basically the common trend in online prices. Whereas you go to your corner shop, they might change the price of milk or coffee twice a week. Online, it happens in milliseconds. How does it work? It works with us outsourcing to third parties or doing it ourselves if we're a big company, engaging in dynamic pricing. The idea of dynamic pricing is wonderful. You try to understand what are the options available outside, what is on offer, what is the level of demand supply, and you amend your price accordingly to maximize. But dynamic pricing these days is being combined with personalized pricing. It's being combined with data that is basically being harvested from us. All of you have those equipments that harvest data in your pockets. These are your mobile phones. You have them on your desk in your office. These are your PCs. We have them all around us. Even those of you who are very prudent and actually ask not to be followed, it can be actually deducted from your social environment, from your friends, from your contacts, from your emails. So our ability today to get a picture of who you are is immense. Now, at the very basic level, I don't need much. Most dynamic providers today, those that provide you with dynamics and personalized price, need very little. The basic service will include me knowing the time, knowing your postcode or your location, and the path that you took in order to reach my shop. At a very basic level, if you come to me, let's say I sell taps, you come to me directly, the price that you will receive for the tap will be higher than if you came to me through Bing or Google. Why? Because when you come through a search engine, my assumption is that your outside options are available. That means that you are aware of the other options. That means that your willingness to pay will be lower, and that means that I should give you something which is a more competitive price. If you come directly to me, I will charge you more. Try this at home. Put anything in your basket on any website and leave the basket. Go and surf. Most times you will get a window. The window will be, come back, 10% discount, come back to us. And if you ignore that, you will be followed by emails for 3 days. Hey, you forgot something. What about this? I mean, what's going on? So what is this? Now, this is framed as a discount, which is beautiful because framing effect is really helpful. It is framed as a discount, but from a competition perspective, this is discriminatory pricing that tries to assess what is your reservation price. What you're telling me by not concluding the transaction is that I misjudged your reservation price. I overestimated your willingness to pay. And what I do, therefore, is I try to correct it. I correct it by giving you something. Now, examples that are absolutely real. This is not futuristic examples. If you search when you're using your MacBook, you will pay more in many outlets than if you search using a PC, because those of us who have a MacBook actually signal that we are willing to pay more. We value quality, and we value brands. If you search from a postcode that is affluent, you will pay more. If you search, so all these elements are taken into account. Now, this is simple. Now, what we really have is an issue where we have a complete asymmetric information. Most of you, even if you are really sophisticated, you think, you know what, I'm going to search for flights here, but I notice as the price goes on that it goes up as my search goes on. So I will then leave that computer and I'll go elsewhere. For me, this is an example of you using analog means to try and combat a digital agenda. It's like us going to the casino and believing that we will win. But the house always wins, even if you have winners, even if you can sit on a flight and you laugh because the person next to you paid £300 more, you only won in that instance. You don't even know how much more you won. So we have a real issue here where the price, the environment that we see, has very little to do with competition. The competition that we are familiar with. It is an environment that is actually designed to you. And yet, if you discuss this with competition agencies, and we've been discussing this with almost all the leading agencies, you either have economists that will tell you, well, you know, distribution of profits is not a competition problem, or competition law is not about fairness, or this is really not a real issue for us to address. But gladly, I can say that recently there is an element here that people start to appreciate, that there is a real issue here, a real element of unfairness, of abuse, of asymmetric information, and literally misleading customers. Just to give you an example of the simplest remedy that we can provide that would result in empowering you. What about when you want to buy anything online, you also being provided with a comment, this price was designed for you, using data on you. What about if I just tell you the average price paid for this mug today was £3 and the price I offer you £6.5. Would you buy it? No, you wouldn't. Now, one of the things that we have is fairness's limiting principle. Amazon already twice went public apologizing for messing with your results. So just so you will understand, it is not necessarily that I change the price. It's enough that if I know that you have more money, that I take the cheap results, I plug them on page 3, and I give you the more expensive results. So it is a lot about behavioral elements, a lot about the way that we understand you you serve. The future is the digital butlers. I don't know how many of you have already those wonderful echoes in your living room, but what I do know that you have something in your pocket such as Siri or Alexa or something that you can use. And some of you today will use it just to say, Siri, order a Chinese, order an Uber or something like that. But as we go on, we will move from us ordering food or asking for the weather or asking for an article to us relying more and more. And this, from a competition perspective, is a significant move, because the first one to get to your home will become your gatekeeper. You will take that, and this will become the entity, the platform, that will start learning about you. And because of that, the switching cost is immense. That platform, now powered with AI, will be able to tell you stories that are relevant to you. Say something funny when you're feeling a bit sad. Do all the things that just cater to your needs. And then when you tell that platform, I need an airline ticket, it will have so much knowledge about your outside options and willingness to pay that it will be able, actually, to do all the things that I just described, but in a much better way. And if there will be someone else, let's say you are interested, you're now surfing Facebook, you write something to your friend about buying trainers, you get suddenly a message, how about Nike? Here is a link to Nike. Now imagine now Reebok coming to Facebook and saying, hey, can we please tell them about this discount? And the question is, would you like access to that person? Well, you need to pay. So what we're doing is, the future is us willingly locking ourselves into these things. And the trick here is to distance us from the market. I don't know how many of you have the amazing Prime buttons in home. These are the buttons that you can buy. You put them above your washing machine. You're out of washing powder. You just press it. Now, this is really lovely, and we all appreciate the convenience. But from a competition perspective, this is a mechanism to bypass the market. Because when you press it, you're not getting the deals. You're not getting anything. The more I'm able to have a first move advantage, the more I will be able to create a universe for you. In reality, in the future, we might not have a market price. Already today, any company that engages in dynamic pricing is not talking about what is the market price. There is a base price. Now, when you go to a shop, we don't bargain in shops, but let's say you decide to bargain in shop. It's a one-way option. It's either you pay the listed price or you pay less. Online, it's a two-way thing. There is the base price, and most of us will pay more. Some of us will pay less, by the way. The first time you go to a shop, there is an acquisition cost. In other words, to acquire you, they will give you a discount. And the wealthier you are, by the way, the greater the discount will be, if we want to speak about inequality. Because your life, the assumption of what I can squeeze out of you, dictates that I should give you a bigger discount. Now, some of you will say, okay, this is all nice, but surely there are companies that are developing the purest butler, some sort of a super entity that will present, some sort of a plug that I'll just put on the helper, or maybe something that I will use to conceal my identity. How about we have a website that will conceal the identity? Now, there is a long discussion on why this doesn't work, but the bottom line is that because we're dealing with network effects, what really happens is that the purest butler is actually incapable of providing you those services. So we cannot invent a state-owned Google or Bing. What we can do is create some entities that will try to shield us. And in the majority of cases, the examples that we have is that then the networks, the platforms would actually say, I'm sorry, either this infringes intellectual property rights, either this creates a suboptimal operation. For any reason, they will just prevent you from using them. And this is basically a bundling issue. It's either you take it or you go away. So the power really resides not with us. The power resides with those platforms. And those platforms are immense. The two super platforms that all of us have in our pockets are either Apple operating system, or some of you may have Android. That's it. These are the two giants of the future. Microsoft tried to enter it. There are talks about Nokia maybe entering it. Maybe we'll have another super platform. The fact is that in this market, what we have is an upstream market that is dominated by two gatekeepers. And then we have all the apps. And those apps are basically captive. Even Facebook, which is a super platform in itself, tells its shareholders that one of the main risks they face is the likelihood that one of those super platforms will undermine the interoperability. Uber, which is a significant company, cannot survive without one of them. So when you think about it, the power that they have goes way, way beyond what is usually attributed to them when we think of it using traditional competition tools. In fact, what we have is a rise of new type of power with extremely valuable network effects. Because these network effects mean that it's much, much harder for anyone to enter this market. And when the bigger gets bigger, what we have is also the possibility to undermine any potential entrant. Because what you will hear often is, look, but what about disruptive innovation? Where is IBM? Where is Microsoft today? These are always the examples that you will hear. And of course, IBM changed its business model. It's not the IBM of yesteryear. And Microsoft is not the giant that we knew. It is changing its business model. But now, because we're dealing with network effects and big data and big analytics, the ability of new disruptors to enter the scene is undermined. And there is a quote here from Peter Thiel from PayPal, and it's just a beautiful one. Competition is for losers. And what does it mean? It means that in this market of winners take all, once you win, once you're at the top, then you look down and you really see the competition. And whoever wins the competition will be number two at best. So that is the issue. It is so difficult. You will have anecdotal stories about someone that succeeded. I'm not saying that Google will stay with us forever, nor that Facebook is with us until the end of our life. Maybe there will be changes. But just as if you have suddenly a sunny day in the middle of winter, you don't argue that maybe global warming is not an issue, or it is an issue, so is in this case. When you have anecdotal changes, when you have just examples of things happening, it shouldn't distract us from the change in the dynamics of competition. One example of it is mergers and acquisitions. Now with new technology, what we sometimes refer to as nowcasting or other means, I can identify who is the disruptor. I can do this sometimes before they are even aware that they are the disruptor. I can make them an offer, and I can purchase them. And if I need to submit this to a merger review, and I need to tell an agency about that, the amazing thing is that the agency knows even less than the target company. So they will say, these are neighboring markets. Maybe these markets are completely unrelated. And sometimes the simplest thing is to ask yourself, if this merger gives no value, why on earth Is it worth 1 billion, 2 billions? And that's really a question that sometimes, and if you look now at the Facebook issues with WhatsApp, when one of the issues there, which is now investigated by the European Commission, the merger was approved based on the claim by Facebook that they have nothing to do with the WhatsApp system. They actually cannot use it. And now anyone here who uses WhatsApp knows that you got a message telling you that unless you opt out, all your information will be shipped into Facebook, and the Commission is now investigating that. So it is about us being well behind. It's slow, fast lane technology and slow lane regulation. Okay, so I'll end with this slide. In many ways, I think the key here is to understand that technology changes the dynamic of competition as we know it. Now, this is not the end of the world. It's just the end of competition as we know it. And that's significant enough, because it means that the tools that need to be used by a competition agency, the way we confront issues of consumer protection, need to be amended. There are ways for us to empower the users, empower customers, deal with data, with privacy. There are many ways that will not involve us targeting a specific company, but rather looking at the overall market and trying to align the interests of those giants with our interests as consumers. But against that, what we have is a very difficult task of dealing with quite significant regulatory and intellectual capture. Because what you have here is a really interesting environment. We spoke about the Truman Show for your purchasing, but if you take a few steps back, basically there is also a Truman Show for the market for ideas. And that links us to the discussion we had in the previous panel. The fact that in many ways, those deep pockets are able to affect either visibly through visible lobbying or through other means, just by saying what is competition law about, what is consumer protection about, actually affect the public debate in a way that might undermine any change. Thank you very much.
Oh yeah, we should. You're not clean. That's okay. There aren't any glasses. Oh, that's all right. No, it's all right. It's okay.
It would kill competition.
So, it would be good if any of the panelists have any response to the others. I think there were some nice complementarities and also several small cleavages. So, does anyone want to respond before we go in?
Maybe just about the search. Which is, I think, really interesting in terms of the search results, because the organic search results are really the most important thing for Google, and this is one of the, or for Bing, to that extent. So these are used as the explanation why it's all pure. But one thing that we need to understand is that these days, the organic search results do not start on page one. So page one, which is really what I need in order to move you to take certain action, is only gathered from an internal, basically internal reference, which is Google. So it's kind of interesting that there is this purity, which is impressive, and I believe, and I might be wrong, but I believe Google is very keen on keeping it impressive, but keeping it pure. But the fact that through some changes to the infrastructure, changes to the interface, what we actually get at the front is actually designed to enable them to leverage market power from one market to another to affect our access to other services. So it makes it a very challenging issue, because then it's all about, is the way they present it optimizes our experience? What is really the goal that we have? Is it about optimizing what you and I think when we go online? Or is it about them not pushing out as efficient competitors? So it actually opens it to quite a challenging policy questions.
Yes, definitely a really good point. So this opens up again and yet another way of thinking about power, right? So we haven't talked at all today about everyday material discursive forms of power. The list, for instance, right? So a search engine results page is basically a list of links. And there's all these other things around, and the core is still absolutely right, the organic search results. But there's something interesting about a list, right, and what it means to get across the idea that you mentioned, Ariel, of a list as pure. I mean, a list is always prioritized. It's always sorted. It's kind of a perfect ordering device for certain tasks in many ways. And so this is something really interesting to think about lists then and how lists are used, because if there necessarily is one at the top and one in the second place and one in the third place, then what does it mean to have a pure result, right? So that's basically impossible. So then the questions now that you mentioned and that I'm also very interested in. So how do we know what counts as a good results page? So good for whom and according to what measures? What are the methods, the practices that we use to figure that out, right? What are the kinds of testing or A-B testing that happens there? What is with this thing, with this other very interesting animal called user experience, right, that is often brought up in this context, right? That's not a trivial concept. It's a highly political and a concept that involves a whole lot of issues, right? So what counts as user experience for whom? And then at the end, of course, always the question, even this category of the user is a producer's category, right? Usually people did not come up and would call themselves users. This is something that producers came up with at some point. And so I think being sensitive to these issues and these concepts, I think, gets us a huge step ahead in understanding some of the power relations in these platforms.
Yeah, and I think very related to that is how data about use is collected. Thank you. When I was doing interviews with people who do information retrieval, they would say, you know, we don't believe in anecdotes. So if a user comes to us and says, you know, I searched for, I don't know, yoga mats, and I keep on getting, like, this thing that has nothing to do with yoga mats, they're like, we do not believe in the anecdote, right? Like, we have to do testing with thousands and millions of people, and then we know what's going on with the system, and we know what the users want. But I think what happens again here is that there's this idea that the user intentions can be read from the data that is being collected about their use of the system, right? And it's kind of interesting there that collapse gets made. And this is the point, I think, where companies will say, we know the users better than them, which means that they're basically saying the knowledge that we gather with whatever indicators we decided were important about user behavior tells us more about them than what they actually want, right? And so they're creating this hierarchy about intention being subordinate to what you do, which I think is very problematic. And I think it's very central to these stories of, you know, being able to identify exactly what you want and serve exactly what you need. In order to be able to do that, they need to create that hierarchy. And I think it will be very important to show that the hierarchy is not true, that people can sometimes do things even though they don't want them, you know, and think about what are ways of bringing in user intentionality that is not reduced to data signals, basically.
Super. So we've got the first set of three questions, very concise. One here, then Hal Hodson at the back, and then Maria Powell.
Hi, Philip Sheldrake. Just a quick anecdote. For the last 3 years, I've spun up a virtual machine. I'm someone who's living in London with an iMac. So for the last 3 years, I've always shopped, especially for travel products, by spinning up a virtual machine and using a VPN to exit somewhere outside of London. It does make a difference, I'm telling you. But there's just two observations I'd like to make. The first one is about what you described as the digital butler. I always prefer the phrase surveillance interface, just so that people know what they're getting themselves into. And for the last 4 years, I've tried to go around to what I call tier two companies to tell them what the tier one companies are about to get away with this surveillance interface, to see if perhaps they might want to change the landscape in order to save themselves the tolls that you just described. And I can categorically tell you that they just said, that's just how business is going to be, and we'll just get on with it, and tier two will always be a level playing field for tier two, and we can't catch up with tier one. So already multi-billion pound tier two companies have resigned to this reality, which is a little bit of a shock. The second observation is on the SEO side of things. I've always been struggling with algorithmic accountability, if only because it's a Gordian knot in some respects. But if you look at the PageRank algorithm in particular, I like to call it, it's a little bit, instead of Schrodinger's cat, it's a little bit like Google's penguin, except that instead of opening the box to see if the cat is dead or alive, as soon as you open the box to look at penguin, which was the name they gave to one of their major algorithmic updates, the penguin is dead. Because as soon as you see the algorithm, it is of no use to man or beast from then on. And I therefore do not know how on earth we can govern systems like that.
So this is really for Ariel, I guess. I love the comparison between old-fashioned offline markets and new online markets, and it seems to me that the biggest difference is the speed at which data moves through the market. That's what allows you to surveil an entire online market and to direct consumers. You could hypothetically do that if you had 100 people watching an offline market. You could direct their traffic and make them buy certain things at certain prices. And I wonder whether a break that might be put on that in order to preserve the old model of marketing or of making a market is to give individuals and producers more control over what happens with their personal data. That's obviously a big challenge, but it seems to me that all the breaks have gone from how data flows through the system, flows through the marketplace, and might one way to fix that be to put the breaks of consent and, you know, autonomy on people's choices in the marketplace.
Thanks. I'm Maria Farrell. So I'm going to expose myself as a member of the liberal cosmopolitan elite because I'm going to tell a dinner party story. Apologies. Sat down beside an economist at the Bank of England a few months ago, and we started talking about competition. And Ariel, you mentioned the phrase regulatory and intellectual capture. This is exactly one of those. I started talking to him about Google and search and, you know, some of the competition issues. He could not get his head around the idea that there could be problems with the market where for consumers were not being harmed, basically by an uncompetitive two-sided market, which was easily open to manipulation. But this guy was a classic Chicago school economist, and basically where there was no clear consumer harm, there was no competition issue. And you know, how do we get across to these guys?
Play a game that I'll try to guess his name.
I've heard that stuff. You know, this was kind of a working level guy, but I've heard that stuff as well from people, you know, all the way up to the top of the tree, and just saying that kind of the Google talking points about markets. And when we try and have a conversation with people, somebody's got there already.
I think we have to serve some tinned salmon.
All right, let's have some responses to those questions. There was a question about data, the inevitability, and then the. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Algorithm accountability, massive issue. Some competition agencies say that in theory, simple algorithms, they can take them, put them in the sandbox and get a sense of how they work. But with neural networks and where we are now heading with algorithms, it will be impossible. So the future is one that even if you had agencies, and the Bundeskartellamt, that's the German competition agency, announced last week that they are now thinking of establishing a digital agency. So they are the most aggressive enforcer that we have in Europe. They're actually going ahead. Margaret Vestager, the head of the European Commission, Director General for Competition, spoke last week about all these issues. So there is a movement, but even if when there will be will, there might be absolutely that, an issue with our ability. And then the question is, what do you do? Margaret Vestager said, therefore I'm suspicious of any price that is determined by a machine. But this, of course, we all understand here, this is a little bit of a misunderstanding of how our universe is comprised. So I think it will be a massive thing. Google, about, you know, how the model works, very brief anecdote. If you have Android phones, some of you may have downloaded Flashlight app. Flashlight app, most of us assume that the business model is advertisement, but of course it's not. The business model for that flashlight was tracking you all the time, even when the app is closed. They were prosecuted by the FTC. Following that, now if you download the flashlight, let's say page 16 of whatever it is that you'll have to agree to in the conditions, will now tell you that they track you all the time. So really, it doesn't matter. Now, in parallel to that, there is another application that is called Disconnect. Disconnect was an application that you can download, and when anyone tries to contact your, to access your contacts, sell your information, do anything, Disconnect starts an alarm. Okay? Who do you think was delisted from the Google shop? Okay? Disconnect. So it tells you a lot about the business model. It's a business model when data is a currency, harvesting and selling. And in that business model, actually, we are at the bottom of the hierarchy. Speed of data online, absolutely, it is relevant to a model that I didn't discuss here, tacit collusion, collusion between between algorithms. This is something which is very significant. We discuss it in the book. The possibility that because you have that speed and you have predictability, you will have less mavericks because of the evolution of algorithms, and actually you can stabilize the market at a, under current laws. You can do it completely legally. And regulatory... Sorry?
In the United States.
No, also here. Tacit collusion is a unilateral reaction to market characteristics, which in itself is legal. And it is different from concerted practice or an agreement where you have something that feels like a cartel or feels like signaling. Tacit collusion means that if we have a market with three of us and you increase the price, it does not make any sense for me to stay down because you will then see that you're losing business, you will drop the price back. So the whole market goes up. We don't punish for that because we cannot punish people for acting rationally. Now shift from our environment with three sellers to an environment of algorithms that are predictable. No one has a good day or a bad day. There is very fast movement. So in a millisecond, they can punish me for trying to undercut you. So there is no arbitrage. There is no way for me to profit. And in such a world, moving from a market of three people, we can actually establish tacit collusion with a market with all of us in it. And it's legal. Which might explain why all the prices are very similar. That and also the fact that dynamic companies are very few and they're using very similar brain. I think I should probably stop with that.
I think sometimes we think of algorithms as kind of stable things, but actually there's a moment of conception, there's a moment of evolution, and maybe there's a moment of removal. And so to do algorithmic accountability for me needs to apply to the whole process rather than an object in and of itself, right? Because if I have an algorithm, it was very interesting when I did the interviews with the software developers, they said, for algorithms that we do for ad companies, because there's money involved, we don't mess around with the features a lot. Like if we say this is the feature remains, we'll maybe update it every 3 months. But with features that we're developing directly for end users, which is not like a direct source of income, we play around all the time, right? So it's kind of interesting to know that there are these kind of hierarchies where there's care with what kind of testing is done and the impact, and where there isn't. And I think partially coming back to, there was a question about whether the data flows, for example, could be controlling data flows. This whole process is super data intensive. And the question is like, who is affected in each and every one of these parts? And you can't just give an algorithm to a regulator and have them test it on their own because it works with the data together. So I think there's quite a bit of thinking to be done about whether the process that is in place right now is reasonable and how it impacts our everyday infrastructure, including market competition, et cetera, and come up with principles that will have an effect on how these algorithms are produced, right? And I think we need to talk about that a lot more.
I'm Sally Bratmitova from UEA. I wanted to bring up the issue of a different kind of harm, citizen harm, instead of consumer harm, because we also have algorithms that are now deciding what counts as extremist or what counts as harmful to children in terms of content. And this is a typical balancing of freedom of expression versus protection of minors or other concerns that used to be made by editors in various newsrooms and people. And they were guided by collectively established editorial codes, broadcasting codes. They had self-regulatory bodies or regulators who were overseeing this process. There were some kind of parameters within which this was done. And the algorithms, we don't have any idea what the parameters are. So I'm wondering, is there any place in that process where we could ask transparency, not of the penguin in the box, which would certainly die, but of the tasks that are set, the purposes for which those algorithms are created, and the parameters that are established for them to operate, that there we could ask for transparency and accountability at that level rather than at the actual algorithm.
Yeah, I was very interested in the sense of uncertainty as to what we're actually talking about, which Malte kind of explored. And I think is obviously part of this object. And I was just curious to know whether the speakers had any, if they had to talk about algorithms without talking about software and data, how they would go about it. You hear often people say, use the example of something like a recipe book as being algorithmic. But equally, if you read Veblen from the end of the 19th century, he was very shocked by the unilateral power of managers to just set the rules of technology and not have to disclose this. So is, in that sense, are we actually talking about corporate power that has sort of engulfed our everyday lives, returning to the earlier discussion? So I suppose it's a sort of challenge, or you know, how would you talk about this without talking about data and software? And equally, do you have any kind of pet metaphors or kind of examples from the non-digital analog world that you return to when trying to think about this? Because it does seem that it sort of, there's something kind of intrinsically sort of ontologically rather sort of baffling or slippery about this object at the moment.
Well, my observation kind of follows on from that, and I wondered if actually we need some different analogies. I agree very much with people who were saying before that there is a problem with seeing the algorithm as an object and interrogating as it as if it were a mechanical apparatus. Perhaps a better analogy is with a piece of legislation. With, if you think about the text of a law that's enacted, say, by a state or, you know, at a local level or at a national level, then we wouldn't expect that just reading the text would tell you about its effects. You would do what you were suggesting and look at how it impacted different people and demand accountability where, you know, you felt it might have impacted people unfairly because in discriminatory or biased ways, and perhaps with the not at all according to the intention of the creators. And that wouldn't mean that you'd have to give a kind of magic property to the words themselves, even if the way in which it's framed is important. So just to wonder whether law or legislative codes would be a better way of thinking about algorithms, a better analogy that would make us think about the seriousness of the task ahead of us in terms of trying to demand accountability from the people that write them.
Right, that's a nice set of process and ontological questions, so Walter.
Oh, great. Yeah, it's definitely a slippery concept, and there's, well, I could come up with a lot of words and metaphors for slippery concepts, right? So that's nice, yeah. So I already mentioned Hacking's elevator word, right? Like accountability, transparency, and all these beautiful words that everybody agrees upon, of course, and that can take you basically anywhere you want, right? But it depends, of course, what it is in practice. That's the idea of this elevator word. And there's a couple of other versions of that. And I think, in a sense, all words are like, right, that's just language. But so there's something interesting going on here. So my personal intuition would be to want to learn more about this, how this works in the settings that you mentioned. I don't know if you had a specific one in mind with your citizens examples. Well, so who are the citizens, for instance? Let's not talk about them as citizens or the model citizen after whom we decide these things, but try to figure out, so who are the people who are affected by that? Where are these things happening, actually? I've no clue. I mean, are there control rooms where people get alerts and then they respond to that? Are these devices people carry around with them? What are these users? What is this technology in use on a day-to-day basis? That's something that I would be interested in. What are the implications of that? How does it work in different neighborhoods, in different cities, right? That's something that I would be really interested in. And I think with that kind of empirical sensibility, you would actually get away a bit from the concept of the algorithm, and you would get away a bit from the concept of some pure form of accountability, which I completely understand is very important when you operate in a discursive space of law, for instance, in a courtroom and so on. So that's very important and it fulfills an important role. But if you asked just generally, I would say, I would just love to learn more about this specific case, and I think that's really what we need, in my view. So not necessarily another metaphor, which probably would be subject to the same dynamics and discursive back and forth, because we could do with any other words as algorithms, computers, devices, whatever, but rather the specifics of the situation and trying really to figure out what happens in the neighborhood or with people who buy these things, right? Do people notice that? Is it even a problem? Is it a problem for a competition lawyer or is it a problem for Seda? So that would be really interesting. And so does it actually, do people suffer from that? What about these subjectivities? That's something that I would be really interested in to learn more about. And I know it's kind of flanking the question because it means that you get away from some of these big concepts to everyday practices.
Yeah, I think there's again like an opposite push in terms of software development. The concept of scale is very important right now for startups to be successful. You know, some of the companies that I interviewed, they would have 40 developers for 5,000 school districts, right? And I'm like, if one of them called you every day, you know, or you know, if each of them called you once for something every day, you wouldn't have enough time with your employees. So the scaling means that those kind of fine-tuning and specific needs, unless they hit a specific threshold or they get captured by the system, become invisible or just not dealt with. And it is too expensive for these companies to actually respond to specific local needs that, you know, if Malta would study and find that, you know, school districts or whatever are specifically very affected by certain kind of filtering of children's content or whatever, it'd be very hard to integrate that directly into the system, which is supposed to scale, right? Because it might require human labor, not just programming. If it's programmable, they can do it right away. I mean, if you want to criticize algorithms, it's the best thing you can do for tech companies, because that's what they do. They'll improve it, no problem, right? If you want privacy and you want encryption, if it means more data for the cloud, they'll be very happy to do it. But it's that moment when you take the critique out of just the algorithm, but start looking at the whole process and what gets transformed, that the critique becomes more significant on these companies and what they're doing. To give you an example, we had a discussion recently, and somebody said, what happens if you know, it turns out that algorithms can make better decisions than doctors, right? Like they are better at identifying if you have a certain kind of illness. Isn't it better that we replace the doctors with this, you just go and submit whatever results you need to the algorithm? And then we can, of course, just study this algorithm and see whether it has discriminatory or undesirable effects. But that doesn't change the fact that with the introduction of this algorithm, it could be that you start removing doctors from the health system, that maybe you start removing nurses from the health system, that the due process completely changes, contestation completely changes. So you have to look at not just the results of the algorithm and what it does with the data that is inputted, but how it completely changes the political economy of the environment around it, and then look at harms and see how you're going to be able to deal with it. And that is not just an algorithmic improvement. That's really looking at the whole environment.
I think that's actually something that has I've found through this panel, is that there's almost a power move in itself to focus on algorithmic power.
That's right.
It's channeling a whole bunch of other things. Also, Murray's point earlier about some hoaxes around, you know, the power of data. And actually, it ends up serving, in many ways, powerful interests. So I think that the kind of scrutiny and analysis of the concept is really helpful in getting us away from that concept of a Truman Show for the market of ideas. And I think just three particular ideas that I think to offer a bit of promise for counterpowering it that I've heard from the comments is, one, Hal's point about robust assertions of some sort of community or individual inalienable or access rights to data that sort of would return some benefit to communities and would generate the kind of access and information rights that we discussed this morning. The second one is about this sort of push and pull of the cloud and taking a look at the economic and, I think, quite significant use of the word colonial move that's involved in that, and whether it's setting us up for catastrophe and what sort of interventions we'd make. And the final is, I think, that really strong turn in competition law enforcement that actually recognises what this new power that's being added to corporate power actually introduces. So there are some angles, I think, that are promising there. But we're going to wrap it up, and I'm going to turn to John and David to close.